I have so much I want to say, and there are about 400 entry points. So I'm going to pick one and we'll just see where it goes, but the line that keeps hitting me is, how do you stay sane in an insane world? How do you stay pure when there's toxicity all around you and even inside you? Excuse me. And what do we really know about the world to say that it's sane or insane? What does it need to conform to for us to make a judgment? What do we know? This morning I woke up thinking of a moment when I was 4 years old and I was listening to the radio and they were talking about the Jolly Green Giant. And he was on the radio. And I ran to my cousin Wendy and I said, there's a giant at the radio station, which for me was on 8 Mile Road near Schaefer. There was a radio station with a big tower. And I was convinced, I heard it on the radio. There was a Jolly Green Giant at the radio station. And my biggest fantasies and fears were all confirmed by a voice coming through the ether. And I was so excited, and my cousin Wendy wasn't sure whether we should believe in giants or not believe in giants, and she was 6 months older than me, so I was looking for affirmation. And we both started trying to believe this was real, and what did it mean, and how fast could that giant reach our house? And it was really kind of terrifying and thrilling to know that the rules of the world as we knew them were being blown apart by some huge announcement coming through the airwaves. And we ran to my mother to say, Mom, there's a giant at the radio station and he's going to come this way. And she was totally enthralled by our excitement. And then she said, honey, there's no such thing as giants. It's an advertisement. I don't know what that was. It's just, she tried to explain it to me, but it didn't register. But I looked to her for affirmation that whatever the radio waves were telling me, whatever my mind was telling me, whatever the images were that were pouring through me, there was a higher voice, older and wiser than mine, that said, don't worry, there is no giant at the radio station. Which didn't mean that every time I drove along 8 Mile Road and saw that tower, I didn't conjure him up. And to this day, when I think about it, I still see that giant. Our minds are fed all sorts of information. Radio waves seem to be more important than the visible range of things. I don't know why, but that's how I felt. And yet the solidity of my mother's calming voice was everything. It just said, it's okay. There's no giant. And I got calm and quiet, and I was able to walk around thinking she may be wrong, but for right now, I was better off believing what she had to tell me. The world around us still feeds us with people saying things coming through the airwaves that our mind grabs onto and makes real in ways that we imagine, in ways that we conjure, in ways that we want to believe, and in ways that we hope isn't true. And what's really interesting is there are not many people we can go to right now who can tell us there is no madness coming over the waves. It's not real. It's just something coming over the, now we have a video, we have images, we have sound, we have all of this stuff coming into our lives. And I don't have my mother or anyone to really go to say, honey, it's okay. It's just stuff coming through the waves, the airwaves. So there's a lot of attention paid by me and everyone else I know, like my cousin Wendy, who are going, maybe it's going to come. What's it? What is it? How big is it? How tall? It's green. I forgot to tell you that. It's a green giant. Jolly, I didn't know what that meant, but we have all of these things telling us that the world is in is being attacked by forces, that there are big forces operating in our lives. So where does one go? Where does one go for the internal, internal, eternal mother that says, honey, it's okay. It's okay. Well, you all know what I'm going to say because I say it every week. There's one place to go. There is a place of calming reassurance that talks to you like your mother would if you had a good mother or someone that you put into a place of authority. You can go into this place, which is a heightened clarity, a higher awareness than yours. And it basically can go, honey, it's okay. This is just stuff that's going on. I know it's on the radio, I know it's on the television, I know it's happening all around you. But if you come in here, there's a still pointedness, there's a quietude, there is a place that you can come where none of that really is going to touch you. It's not real in any ultimate sense. Now, there are those of us who have found a pathway to that inner space, and there are many people who don't know how to get there, or don't even know that there's a there that they can go to be embraced by stillness and a larger awareness. Not that we don't all have some access to it, and I talk about this, I know, a lot. The moment in every human being's life that gives them that momentary comfort and assurance is that which happens just as you're falling asleep, just as you're going to bed at night. There is this thing that starts to take you in. If you're lucky, I have friends who don't have such easy access to that and fight for hours to have that moment occur. But at some point, that moment just comes and you go, okay. And it takes you into a restorative, comforting, clarifying space. It gives you an opportunity when you wake up the next morning to kind of start at zero. Most of us don't. But you can kind of wake up and recalibrate. Take a breath, hear the birds outside the window, feel the comfort of the air. Know it's a new day. Anything can happen. And you wake up with this sense of refreshment and possibility. Now, if you reach for your cell phone immediately and turn on the headline news, you're back into the green giant. You're back into the assault of the senses of stuff coming at you. And that's easy. It's easy to do in our current culture as we become more and more addicted to outer form, outer experience, that there is stuff out there that is at the radio station or the TV station that's speaking what we think of as truth, especially because it's a collective truth. We're all sharing it and it's very big. And so we experience a collective, if I can label it that, insanity. Insanity. We're all believing in all of these conflicting sources and forces and things that we believe to be true and don't want to be true and don't know what to make of and don't know what to do about it, and we feel helpless in their face, and our inside system starts to become impacted by the sort of toxic arena that which we live in, and we start to feel all of this drama in our psyche. And one needs to find a corrective. How do I live in that space without becoming totally inundated in the world's suffering and the world's problems, and how do I keep it from becoming my own? Well, again, one has to enter into one's inner space and find the cave of recollection, of reconnection, of reawakening, of peace and love, and sit in that space, knowing full well that you also will be living in the world of madness. You will be looking at people around you who are caught by that madness. You'll be seeing everyone running around like masses of people saying there's a giant at the radio station. Masses of people. And you will try to become yourself a little bit of, it's okay. It's okay. Now, some days you may start to get caught up in that belief system again, but if you have a discipline and a practice, you can bring yourself back into this core space that will keep you sane. But if you don't have a practice and you don't have an awareness of a place you can retreat to, you will be washed over by the powers of the madhouse that we live in. Rudy called the Earth the Bellevue of the solar system. For those of you who don't know Bellevue, it's an insane asylum that used to exist in New York City. And people were committed there. Now we don't have so many institutions. Everyone's on the street, almost literally. We don't have asylums anymore. And so people are thrown into the midst of the madness, and we are inundated with mad people on the street who are in fact now more and more looking like us. That we're all kind of a little bit mad. And there is a reason to be mad. In a way, the world is disruptive. There are ugly, unpleasant forces being unleashed. Many of us grew up in a time when there was a kind of what I used to think of as normalcy, and people behaving within a certain norm that was acceptable. It was called civilization. We were civilized beings, and we lived in a spectrum where we behaved well, and madness was kind of kept in abeyance. But now those norms are being eroded. Anybody who watches the news or watches television or reads newspapers or is involved in the culture at all knows that those norms are eroding, and that our job, if we want it, in a sense, is to try as best as we can to maintain those norms in our small personal and intimate social circles. We can do that within the family, within the community of friends. We can be groundswells of sanity and handholding and comfort and compassion for one another. We can say, yes, the world is going crazy, but we, maintaining our civilized nature, can inform each other, can reinforce each other, can bring joy and pleasure to ourselves and to one another in this moment. So there's a real value in dealing with what you might call the PTSD of the societal reality around us right now. And I don't know how many of you are being affected by it. I can only tell you, speaking from my own honest truth, that I am being affected by it. That I look around me and I go, wow, this is pretty awful. And I've had this awakening in my life, which in a sense broke down the walls of the Bruce Rubin character, so that what's happening in the awakening of my experience is that I no longer have a barrier, a shell, a protective force around me to protect me from these forces. I am feeling every one of them. The protection, however, for me is within. That when all of this stuff, the world suffering, if you will, starts to fill the space, I can go back into my own private sanctuary and be touched by higher forces that tell me it's all right. It's okay. There is no giant at the station. And I'm very grateful for that. And I try to share that with you because it seems to be my job. I understand the possible desire among awakened people, spiritual seekers, yogis, whatever you want to call them, meditators, to use meditation as a hiding place so as not to have to engage the madness. And I can't be critical of that. I totally understand why somebody would want to go into a place where this is no longer about you and no longer something you have to engage. You will just live in your private little cave of meditative comfort. But there is a tradition in Buddhism, which I had always heard and always understood to be a noble space, which is called the Bodhisattva tradition. The Bodhisattva tradition is you have lived in the world and you have, through your own endless effort and the grace of the being of existence, found a pathway outside of individual private suffering. And you could, if you want, live in that space of great simplicity and kind of internal solitude. You could, I look at people like Nityananda in our root tradition, who so transcended the norms of bodily awareness, of individualized consciousness, he became this fountain of availability, but he was not particularly engaged, if you will, in the world of activity. He was really a fountain of consciousness. He did interact with people. He did touch people. He did feel for people. And there are endless stories of miracles that he created in the world. But what was so beautiful about him is that he stayed in a very simple space and let this stuff flow out. And I really, really understand that. But the Bodhisattva tradition, you engage. You go back out into the world primarily to help people who have lost their way or who are suffering in the madhouse of the world. And you go out there in whatever way you can, awakened or unawakened, you go back out into the world and you try to hold hands, massage people, bring them into a comfort zone of it's going to be okay, there is no giant at this station. Your job is to reach the world, stay in the world, to step aside from your own awakened awareness and be part of the culture. Be part of the thing that serves humanity one at a time, one person at a time. You don't have to think of yourself as saving the world. You just do the work that's in front of you day by day. And believe me, there will be stuff in front of you day by day. And you, what you try to do is engage people in this feeling mode, not necessarily intellectual, but some kind of visceral connectivity to another human being that allows them to start to feel comfortable. This class that we do is a really interesting class. It's energetic, meaning it's not physical exactly, it is energy systems interacting. The closest we come to this in the material biological world is sex. Sex is a fascinating universe because it only has a little bit to do with intellect and mind. You give yourself over to something else that is a, and I'll use the word again, visceral experience. It directs you, it leads you in places your mind will never grasp even. Why am I doing that? Why does being touched here or being felt that happening create such powerhouse of experience inside? What is this universe of sexuality that dominates us so strongly in the material world? And how does that imply, how does that address itself into the spiritual? Well, I will tell you, they're very similar and perhaps deeply connected. But the thing I want to talk about is that the meditative experience, the experience of this particular class being energetic, and in fact, most of our experience with other human beings is often energetic, is a feeling into the byways of another human being, where they're open, where they're closed, where you can connect to them, where you cannot connect to them. And when you know you've connected, it's just like that, what happens sexually. When you start to feel another person sexually, it's like a joy opens up in you that is exquisite and beautiful. When you're meditating and working with another person, the experience of connectivity has exactly that kind of expression, this sense of, ah. And it leads you, it leads you. I know when I sit and lead the class, and when I work with people outside the class, whether they know I'm working with them or not, I am finding doorways into places that have that kind of almost orgasmic, ultimately orgasmic, this beauty of connectivity, exquisite connectivity. So that when you go into the world, into the madhouse, to offer your compassionate touch to life, your bodhisattva expression, it's not necessarily an intellectual convincing of people that anything is going to be okay. It's something else. When my mother told me there was no giant at the radio station, it wasn't the words she said that were important. It was her assurance. It was her clarity. It was her calming me down. It was her sense of knowing how to address my needs in a way that allowed me a certain kind of assurance in the world that I could continue in a realm of activity that would not be threatened by these magical, strange, phantasmagoric experiences that were frightening. The role of a bodhisattva is energetic. It's to go into the world and to begin to know how to interact with other people. And the way you know that is feeling. It's feeling. But it's not just emotional feeling, and it's not just biological feeling, and it's not even just sexual feeling. It's this thing which I call visceral feeling. It's a visceral knowing. And when it comes in, it is sexual, it is emotional, it is every kind of way of knowing all being expressed. And what you feel with another human being is connection. Like, that's what you feel. It is so exquisitely beautiful, so essential, and so self-aware. And what's really happening in that moment, at least in for me, and this is the magic of spiritual teaching, is that I feel this visceral awareness talking to me, pushing me, leading me in ways that I make no sense intellectually. And it just says, go here, go there, follow this, quiet, stop, go, sit, open, move, do this, do that. It just talks to me. And I just do nothing but listen and respond. And I feel in this listening and responsiveness that I am serving something greater and something higher. I do not understand what it is, but it sounds like my mother's voice. It sounds like something that tells me it's okay. Be okay. Be one with what I speak. Share this truth with others. Open the doorway for them to hear and experience and know this truth. That's the true service of a bodhisattva. You allow the voice from on high, whatever you want to call it, higher consciousness, God consciousness, cosmic awareness, to come through unimpeded, meaning you are so surrendered and so out of the way that it just keeps flowing through you. Nityananda did this. I know every minute of his life, and I know that I am a student of this. But I have been learning and learning how to be present with this higher awareness and to share it with each of you. And its goal in being shared with you is for you to be able to say to the world and to yourself, there is no giant at the radio station. You become a servant of sanity in the world. You become a servant of kindness and compassion and authority and assurance for other people. Not for your sake, not to make you the great soul and the great knower of things, because you know very clearly you know nothing other than one thing, how to allow this exquisite, extraordinary, sexual, pleasurable, beautiful, reviving energy to move through you and into the world to bring about transformative awareness in the people around you. This is what we do. This is what you are training to do. This is what you have the capacity to do. You are the ones who are sitting here listening to this because you are available to it. You are the mechanisms that will be used by the universe in a bodhisattvic way to help the world in whatever small or vast way you're capable of doing. And it doesn't matter. Your job, really, your job is to be an allower of higher consciousness to work through you and to serve the world, period. You can say to the world, I'm not ready, I'm not high enough in my own awareness, I'm not open enough, I'm too imperfect. It doesn't care. It doesn't care. It wants you. It wants you. It needs you. This energy is there for the world, and not many people hear it. It wants clarity. It wants truth. As best you can emanate it. And you will discover it is wildly loving, open, accepting, clarifying, motivating, giving, and demanding. Those of you who heard my talk last week know that I feel, in a sense, got tipped over the edge of the madness of the world by the stuff that's happening at the borders of taking children from their parents. It was like, that was it for me. I could not sit back and watch that happen. It was so awful. And I talked about it in my class, and I said, I am just looking for guidance of what can I do to impact that particular situation. And it was amazing. People in the class started coming forth with possibilities of such incredible value that I was like, wow, all you have to do is open your mouth and express what you feel is your truth or the truth or the thing that is dominating your consciousness and watch what comes back. It is remarkable. It is remarkable. So I have set off on a mission, probably more to come when I talk about it down the road, of doing what I can do to help raise consciousness about something that is a kind of new evil in our society, in our culture, in our government. And I find it unacceptable. I've not been an activist for many years. Rudy had a big thing about being an activist back in the 60s and early 70s when I was on protest marches, and he kind of said, you got too much work to do than to go out there in the field of people's anger and just be angry. That wasn't for him meaningful. But I think he might feel differently at this moment, and I know I do. So I'm trying to find my way into how do I bring this spiritual higher sanity into the growing insanity around me. Again, I think we all have opportunities to figure that out. I'm not trying to call you into account. You don't have to do anything, but I'm trying to let you know that if you're going to be, excuse me, a bodhisattva, if you're going to tell people that there is no giant, jolly, green or not at the radio station, then you will be doing a service to people who have phantasmagoric ideas about what's happening around them. Let's calm the center down. Let's speak truth to madness. Let's hold people, and let's get beyond the intellectual even, and let's feel our way into what people need in their lives. Mostly it's love, it's touch, but it's also on your own inner mechanism. Imagine yourself in some fundamental way making love to, not necessarily sexual love, but you can call it that, making love to everyone around you. That's kind of what we're doing. We're making love to each other. It's the bodhisattva ideal, really. It may not have been taught that way by Buddha, but it's the basic understanding. We are here to serve, to open, to clarify, to hug, to embrace the other. And with some investment in that, we will change life in the world. And we will serve. So I'll leave you with one last thing. There is no Jolly Green Giant at the radio station. Remember that. Any questions?
You are a very verbally oriented person and have an impact through your words, whether written or spoken. And I realized a long time ago that I am not a verbal person. And I decided, or I felt internally, that the way I lived my life was would serve as a model, let's say, for other people. And I still strive for that. I don't know how much impact that has, but I think, you know, it's hard to compete with someone like you who, through your verbal abilities, can have a tremendous, widespread impact.
It's not a competition. Your impact, I've watched your impact on people, from your children to your grandchildren to the people around you. So I have no question that your impact is enormous. Your impact on me has been the most stabilizing thing in my life, other than my own practice. And I know if it wasn't for the words coming out, we wouldn't be here. You know, they were able to translate into, you know, storytelling that became viable for me and an important way of supporting a family. But that part of it was half of the equation. The other half of the equation was you. And those two halves of the equation are necessary for a whole thing to exist. None of us has the total answer. None of us has everything that's wanted. We have what we have. And what we have is profoundly enough, profoundly. And when you really go deep enough inside, you find at some point this voice on high, if you want to call it God or whatever, will tell you, you are, were, have been, and always will be enough. And it's very profoundly grounding and satisfying, because you don't have to compete with any other being on the planet anywhere. You are already the very thing you have hoped to be, and you are. I've lived with you for, it'll be 52 years, and, you know, 51 years in what is it, 20-some days, 19 days. That's a long commitment in this lifetime, particularly in the culture we're in right now. I don't regret a single one of those days. You have created the balance. You've created the harmony. You've created the equilibrium of the life I've had. I could not be sitting here or doing anything if you hadn't been right there. So the competition between verbal and nonverbal, in a certain sense, your nonverbal is what balances out the verbosity that comes from this person, and that makes it a whole thing that your children could grow from, that your grandchildren can get directed by, and we serve. It serves, the brilliance of the patterning that goes on is beyond understanding, and I don't even know how to express it, except there is a unbelievable rightness to things. I mean, I've had a lot of demands in the last week that I did not want to meet. People and things that were coming at me that I just said, I can't handle all this. And the fact is, every one of those beings brought me something of great value. My resistance was stupidity. My openness was teaching, was a teaching. I've always said yes, even when I want to say no. And the yes to everything that happened has been transformative for me. I mean, in ways that, I mean, I can barely express. You're aware of what's been going on. I mean, unbelievably high level connectivities have come out of rejections that I wanted to make that I didn't do, just because the voice in me, the voice from Rudy, the voice from you, the voice that I have says, you get nothing by saying no. Only things only happen if you say yes. So fear not. You know, I can only say this to you a million times, but what you're doing and where you're at and what you've arrived at is so perfect in my existence, and in the existence of the people I know around you, that, you know, all you have to do is allow this deep inner voice to just tell you whenever it will tell you, and it will, you've done great, period. That's all you need to know.
Seeing that if one wants to be a bodhisattva, that it would be important to make sure to sit first.
That's a good idea.
And then go out and do that.
I mean, I think yes. There are a lot of people who go out to save the world without having done any work in themselves. And so they just basically share their madness with the world. I think that's problematic. You know, and I see it all the time. You know, I do think, I mean, one of the hardest things for me, honestly, in this teaching that I do is I say one of the rules that Rudy gave us is that you sit every day for the rest of your life. And I know almost nobody does. But I was one of those people who sat every day, every single day. I did not let a 24-hour period go by where I hadn't sat to connect. And then, you know, as I have said many, many times, it was about 8 years ago now, that changed. This awakening took place and I realized there was nothing, there was no moment when I wasn't sitting. It was just always happening. Happens in the shower, on the toilet, it happens when I walk, it happens when I talk to people. I become a very boring human being on some level. On the other hand, I do speak my truth, or the truth as it pours through, as best it can. And that's who I am and what I do, for better or for worse. I mean, I can see people going, oh my God, Bruce is coming over. Oy. You know, well, that's the way it is. You know, if they won't invite me, and they don't. But I don't have a problem with that. I have become this. I've become who I am, and each of you are becoming who you are. And at some point in time, you will discover that you have such a ongoing capacity to arrive at center, to arrive at the well source of well-being in yourself, that you don't have to walk around proclaiming divinity. You don't have to walk around proclaiming anything. You just will be someone who, by right of the ability to have this abiding awareness or an access to that awareness, that you can walk into the world and speak your truth. Not as the truth, because I don't think any of us should do that, but as your truth. And the more it's informed by higher reality, it will feel like the truth. But, you know, I don't know anybody who in human bodily form can really walk around saying it's the truth. Not that people don't, but I do recommend practice. I do recommend the value of, if you're gonna go to the gym, you go regularly, because otherwise, you know, when you see a 400 pound person sitting around talking about the value of dieting, how does that speak to you? You know, my soul is thin, therefore I can teach anything. Okay, and there are people who will buy that. You know, like, oh, he's thin inside. You know, he's a true being, even though sitting in front of you at 400 pounds, that's your mind going green giant. You know, that's madness. It's total madness. The truth is, as Blanche said, how you live. That's the truth. Look at the way people live as best you can. We don't know how people live really, but every so often you get glimpses into it and you go, oh my God, that's how they live. But in a way, you start to know after a while, we're all very unique, strange creatures, every one of us, but we all have the same hunger and the same need, which is to be, at some point, sane. And anybody who can help make you feel that is a gift. Anybody else? Part of my insanity right now is that my cell phone has decided to lose all of my calendar, all of my contacts, all of my steps for the last 6 months. So all my walking every day is no longer recorded. And so someone said to me, "Well, you can walk for health, you know. You don't have to walk for steps." And I truly buy that, and I'm trying to move into that realm. But I must say, having no contacts and no calendar for the is really disturbing, and Anne is helping trying to restore all of this, but I am getting a feeling of what it means to be insane, to have no access to people you know and love. My text messages come in saying, this may be Ari, my son, maybe your wife, maybe. I'm going, what? But it is my son, and it is my wife, and I'm going, this. My phone is telling me maybe. And I really understand how technologically we're all going a little bit crazy and could go very crazy because we rely on all these outer sources. So what one has to do really is figure out, how can I live with none of the above and still be okay? You know, and that's really important. If I didn't have Anne to help out, I would be in worse shape, but Anne knows how to dialogue with these people who tell you how to fix these things. But at some point, you may have nobody, but you will always have this deeper self that says, take away my contacts, take away my calendar, take away my steps, I'm okay. I am okay, even well. So remember, stay sane no matter what. Walk your walk, talk your talk, share with the world, and be a source of love and compassion. End of conversation.